There is a super chat.
Yeah, top chat.
Top chat. Tony Cash. Hey, Tony, you're a brand new listener. Thank you. Love your content. Had my dog trained by a balanced dog trainer, and it was the best thing I ever did. Tony, awesome. And I know you're keeping up with it because that's the magic. That's the magic sauce, as they say in dog trainer restaurant lingo. So welcome to the show, Tony. I've never seen you before. I'm blessed and honored to have you here. Next.
Nice.
Hey, everybody. How are you? Good evening. How's everyone doing? Hey, everybody on SoundCloud, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google, iTunes, and a couple other platforms that we're on. Welcome to the show. My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and we've got a Q&A show when we do this. It's about the third one this week we've done. Two to three this week. We're out of town this week. Three this week. Usually do three this week. We try to do Monday and Saturday. Then we either do a Wednesday, Thursday show. We try to do them at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And they usually go from anywhere from 60 to 90 minutes, depending on the day of the week and if Joelle's doing it or if Linda's doing it and what their schedule is. If you don't know anything about me, you can go to my website, solidcaninetraining.com, solidcaninetraining.com. And you can learn a lot about us. We've got probably 5,000 videos, 10,000 hours of audio content. We put up 6 pieces of new content a day. Make sure you follow us on Instagram or Instagram stories. Obviously, Facebook, YouTube, on our website. You can go see our seminar tour. Go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com. Hey, Melissa, how are you? If you don't know much about the work that we do, we specialize in aggression rehab, behavior modification. So we deal with some really challenging dogs. So most dog trainers, in fact, I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. Every dog trainer should be able to train obedience. That's a given. And that doesn't actually take long. In fact, somebody was saying, I got an email from somebody who was saying, well, if I would have stuck to it for a couple more years, like it would have worked out. And they were talking about basic obedience. And I'm like, no, it doesn't take that long. So you've been lied to along with the rest of them. So everybody can train basic obedience. Then there's a select group of people that can stop unwanted behaviors. And then out of that unwanted behavior, there's a select group of people who can actually work on true aggression. Most dog trainers can't work on true aggression. Most of them can't even do a lot of serious separation anxiety or any other serious behavior modifications. It's an ego statement, but when you're looking for a dog trainer, you want to make sure that you find the dog trainer that's right for you and that can stop unwanted behaviors. Most people hire trainers to stop unwanted behaviors. So in order to do that, you need to learn how to properly apply punishments. So we're gonna talk about punishment a lot on this show. And a lot of people don't know what it is. They're like, I don't yell and scream at my dog. I'm like, well, neither do we. Like, we don't yell and scream at dogs either. In fact, if a trainer raised their voice at a dog, I'm like, what's wrong? Are you lacking skill set? You know? So there's a proper way to punish a dog. And it's unemotional because you're not mad and you're not angry. You don't agree with the behavior that they're doing. And you're allowing them to know you don't agree, and then you move on. We don't do timeouts. We don't utilize a crate for timeout. We don't, like, bad dog. There's no scolding. There's no nagging at all. It's pretty black and white. So most people on this show, I will be teaching on how to properly apply punishments. We utilize shock collars. I use the word shock collar. If it makes you feel better, you can use the word remote collar. I use the word punishments. Again, if it makes you feel better, you can use the word, correction or, interruption. The thing is that facts just don't care about your feelings. So it really doesn't matter what you feel like. These are the facts. Everything that I do on the show and suggest, I've done a minimum of 100 times successfully. A minimum successfully. If I haven't, I will not recommend it. Most things that I'm recommending, I've done thousands of times successfully across the board on breeds, across the board on breeds. So I'm only giving people advice on things I know about. I'm a family pet dog trainer. Therefore, I don't do sport. I don't do agility. I don't do trick. I don't do fly ball. I don't do actually even competition obedience. So I don't answer those questions. I'm not a vet. I don't answer medical questions. I'm not a nutritionist. I don't answer nutrition questions. I do feed raw, though, but I can't educate you on that. What I can do is highly effectively, I have a special set of skills, and as well as most good dog trainers, is I can stop an unwanted behavior, usually immediately. And that's a good test for, I'm losing my voice here. So coming off of my ribs, every once in a while, the rib injury just pops up. Maybe when I don't shut my fucking mouth. I swear, if there's children out there, I swear. Just sometimes I can't help it, but I use it as an adjective. So I think that's acceptable. All right. So there's a, at the bottom, if you want to ask a question, you should see your screen name. My screen name is Solid Canine Training. And then it says, say something. So say something, but with words. Use your big boy and big girl words. So type in your words there. All right. And then underneath that is an emoji. You can give me an emoji if you want to. There's no middle finger. You're out of luck. Actually, yes, there is. But there is a super chat button. Super chats. You click on that. You can throw some cash. Dollar, dollar, make you holla. And that cash then goes into my pocket. It also gets you to the top of the line. The thing is, we can't answer all the questions. We'll go through a lot of questions. So I spend about 9 hours a week on live interaction with my fans. And that's not even responding to emails, responding to questions. So it gets pretty overwhelming. All right. So here we go.
Here we go.
Joelle, jump right in.
Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Thanks to your videos, my dog is rocking the out command with toys, balls, anything she has in her mouth. Needing advice on how to train, get the heck out of here. Since the e-collar is not directional and I want her to move away from me and can't use the leash for guidance. Thanks so much.
Actually, so Jane, you're going to use the out command as well. And you, first of all, congratulations. So that's, you know, it's really cool that like people can take the free content that I offer and dramatically change the trajectory of their life with their dog and themselves. How awesome is that? So kudos to you for doing the work. Teaching a dog to drop something. And by the way, guys, don't do the switcheroo. Don't do the exchange. This isn't JCPenney's. Because if it was, you'd be out of business. Okay? So the worst thing to do to a dog, the absolute worst thing to do, this is how you train a dog to be actually aggressive. Most people are training their dogs to be aggressive, and it's not through hitting. It's actually through using a reward. So dog has something in its mouth. It's growling. It won't let go. Guess what you miraculously do? You come up with something better. If I want my dog to do more of something, I reward it. So 90% of this show, we will talk about punishments. On the flip side, 90% of the day of the training center is reward-based. Why? We're teaching dogs to do stuff. Once we correct them from some unwanted behaviors, we rarely have to. And then we get to just train all day, teaching them how to do stuff. So outgo isn't directional, but you can use a leash. So what you can do is have somebody help you. You would say out, apply a correction, a punisher with the remote, and then have that person guide the dog backwards. What you could also do is take a long line, make a pulley system by putting it through the leg of a, around the leg of a couch or a entertainment center, or if you want to, you know, Jane, all that S&M equipment you have, you know, back at the house, you've got the swing that sits from the ceiling. You run it through the swing, okay? And then you would pull back. You can do that as well. But dogs are pretty good. When you say out and they feel some discomfort, they actually move away from you. Move, get out of here is a great thing to teach. Next.
Red Riding Hood and the Wolf. I've been thinking about this for a while now, and I've been wondering if I made the right decision. I had a pit bull named Tuesday and the Akita Husky mix Kona. I had Tuesday for a year and Kona for a month. Kona and Tuesday would always get into fights, and when they got into their last fight, Tuesday bit me in the face when I separated them. After that, I was nervous to be around Tuesday, and I fought and I found her a new home and kept Kona. Tuesday was super sweet and never acted aggressively towards anything. Did I do the right thing?
We'll have to say yes on that, Red Riding Hood, and don't lose sleep over it. And stop thinking about it. We will have to say yes. The answer has to be yes. There's no other choice. The answer has to be yes. Okay? I've had to put down dogs, personal dogs, because they were not safe. Did I make the right decision? Yes, I did. Why? Because I made the decision. And no, I'm not always right, but it has to be okay. It has to. So whether you rehome the dog, take the dog to a shelter, put down the dog, we have to accept that that was the decision that you made at the time with the information that you had. So no more. Don't think about this anymore. Okay? As of today, you made the right decision and you smile about it. Okay? Next.
Melissa says, hi, Jeff and Joel.
Hey, Melissa.
Hey, Melissa. The Kate, hi, Jeff and Joel. Sorry we weren't able to connect when you passed through Charlotte. I know you were very pressed for time. Where did you all eat barbecue? Please tell me it was Midwood Smokehouse or Max. Where did we go?
I don't know, but we're just talking about the Charlotte dates, and we're thinking like we might not be till September. We'll be back in Charlotte. I don't remember where we went. It was good. Mm-hmm. It was close to where we were staying because the place we wanted to go was too far away. I don't remember, but I can always check the receipt or I'll message Laura. Do you have Laura's thing?
For what?
You ask the next question.
Okay. Melissa posted the link to your website, rvdogtrainer.com. Kayla.
Where did we go for barbecue? What's the name of the restaurant?
Ready?
Yep.
Kayla, Jeff, I believe strongly in your methods, but I need help with my dog. I just can't fix him alone. I need participation. If I get a trainer, I worry I'll disagree or butt heads with them. What do I do?
Well, first of all, let's fully clarify things. These are not my methods. These are well-documented, well-established dog training methods on how to stop unwanted behaviors. Okay? So some I figured out on my own. Some I learned from other people. But the proper application of punishments is well-documented since the beginning of time. Nature did it first. I follow nature. If you think you're going to be butting heads with somebody, then you will. Okay? If you think you're going to be butting heads with somebody, then you will. If you think you can, and if you think you can't, you're right. 5 points for anybody that knows who first said that. Okay? So what I would do is I would find a trainer that you think can help you. And then there's already one ego in the room. That's the dog trainers. Let's not put two egos in the room. Give it a shot. See how it goes. All right? There is a super chat.
Yep, top chat.
Tony Cash. Hey, Tony, you're a brand new listener. Thank you. Love your content. Had my dog trained by a balanced dog trainer, and it was the best thing I ever did. Tony, awesome. And I know you're keeping up with it because that's the magic. That's the magic sauce, as they say in dog trainer restaurant lingo. So welcome to the show, Tony. I've never seen you before. I'm blessed and honored to have you here. Next.
Nice. Pauline, Joelle, I love your hats these days. So cute. Thanks, Pauline. The brand is Love Your Melon.
That's right. What you really want to say is, Joelle, keep having dirty hair.
It's
the hats. The hats will keep showing up. Yeah. Got it?
And it's cold out, so yes. It's like win-win.
Yes.
John Snow, what is the best type of basket muzzle to use?
I'm going to go with the most practical one for you is Baskerville. The reason is it comes in six sizes, I believe. It's easily available on Amazon. You can also get it at your big box stores. Also, you can actually put them in a little bit of water and stretch them a little bit. You can do food training with them. The dog can wear them for 24 hours if needed. They can drink water and they can eat, but be careful. They can muzzle punch you and they can grab onto your clothing. And Laura's getting back to me.
Oh.
Lancaster barbecue. Thank you. Somebody on the live show wanted to know.
B. Nado. At what age do you suggest starting an e-collar? My pup is 10 weeks old.
Depending on your skill set, we start at 14 weeks. The reason we start at 14 weeks is because we start food at 8 weeks, and then we just layer the remote collar with the food. And all the dog knows is like, okay, fine. There's another collar on me. It's no big deal. Next.
Nicole M. My trainer sent me to your videos for separation anxiety. I got it fixed in a few months, and really it should have taken way less time. Now I know. I know people are still struggling after years. So sad.
So Nicole, yes. Well, first of all, you did it. Congratulations. But people are struggling for years because they have the wrong information. They're literally doing it wrong, but it's not their fault. Nobody fucks up their dog on purpose. What they're doing is they're getting false information from people that are making suggestions that know it doesn't work. They know it doesn't work. Do you know that most positive reinforcement trainers go home and put shock collars on their dogs? I know many that do, and they lie. They're unethical. Why? They know what they're doing has limitations, or it doesn't work. They lie. I know this for a fact. The public needs to be made aware of it. Next.
John Snow, if you were hiring a dog trainer, what things would you look for?
Somebody that's nice. Brain surgeon, I don't care if they're nice or not. I want them to have an incredible skill set. I'm looking for a dog trainer that has mastered the art of communication with humans. That's what I'm looking for. It's not that difficult to train a dog. How do you treat people? Hire someone that's nice. Now, there's a lot of nice dog trainers that don't know shit. And you'll figure that you'll find that out real well. You want to find somebody with a good skill set and is nice. And there's a lot of them out there. Next.
Debbie, professional trainer in Cincinnati, loving your shows.
Awesome. Cincinnati, you? Cincinnati? How's WKRP going? Next. I'm originally from Cleveland, home of the buzzard. WMMS. Got it? Rock and roll, baby. Rock and roll. Saw the last North American concert of The Who. Next.
Okay. Allie Wynn says, hi, Jeff and Joelle. Hi.
Allie, how are you?
Jane, when walking in the forest today with my dog on leash, we saw another on-leash dog. When passing the owner, she couldn't hold her dog and it attacked mine. What's the best way to break up a fight?
Wow. First of all, not too many people use the word forest. Don't they say, like, the woods? Do you use the word forest?
No. I guess not.
It's the woods. But that's not true, though, because when you say such and such forest, that's like in the title of the forest is called, like, the forest.
Yeah.
So if dog attacked my dog, you take your foot. I imagine you had boots on. I hope you were in the forest hiking. I would kick the dog extremely hard. Extremely hard. That's what you want to do. What you don't want to do is pull on your leash. Pull on your leash. And then you take a photo of them, photo of their dog, you get their name and their phone number. And then you will be sending them medical bills, okay? So chances are this is not the first time it's happened, but I always avoid people. I always avoid people and dogs. But you do whatever you possibly could because your dog could die. Your dog may die. I've seen dogs killed before. It's not pretty. I've seen people harmed before. I personally have been mauled before. It's not pretty. So I will do anything I can. Anything I can. If anybody is offended by that, jump off the show. I haven't even begun yet. So you just have not seen the horrors that I've seen. Next.
Lindsay, love the hat, Joelle. Where did you start to get to where you are now, Jeff, at Solid Canine Training? Thanks, Lindsay. Where did I start? Well, my journey.
Gushing like the rest of the people, supposedly.
Came to a seminar and he never got rid of me.
That's pretty much what
pretty
it is.
Pretty much.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a divorce in there.
Right.
It's been a long journey.
It's only been 3 or 4 months.
Yeah.
It's been a wild 4 months, put it that way. Next.
Yep. Angela, when we go to an RV seminar with our dog, what do we need for our dog? Kennel?
you'll get a list. When you buy a ticket, you get a list. You immediately get a list emailed like to you on the bottom of the ticket. But you need your dog. You need food. Don't worry, there's water there. You need a container to keep the water in. You need a crate. Crate's very important. Big thing is you need a crate. Pretty much a dog and a crate and a leash, and you'll make it. And if you don't have a prong collar, we have them. If you don't have a remote collar, we have them. You want to bring a hungry dog because we do use dogs' food drive. Next.
Alexis F. Hey, Jeff. I have a 10-month-old lab who has the habit of burying his head into crotches, men or women, standing or sitting. How can I fix this?
Stop giving the dog dollar bills, number one. Like, what did you think was going to happen? All right? I sniff crotches for $5. So what I want you to do, I mean, for a $10 bill, you don't even want to know what I do. What I would do is I would apply proper punishment. You want to stop something. So what do? You make it suck to sniff a crotch. It's extremely rude behavior. So you have a remote collar on the dog. You would say no, apply punisher. You'll hear me talk about a bonker a lot. A bonker is a wrapped up towel. I'm personally blown away at the people that freak out about the concept of taking a towel, saying no, and boom, throwing it at the dog. Remember, you're not angry. You're not mad at the dog. It's a towel. It is freaking cotton that grows. We actually passed cotton fields.
Yeah.
Where were we?
South Carolina.
South Carolina. We passed some wonderful cotton fields. And all you're doing is saying no. Does it hurt the dog? Well, it might, but it sure as heck startles the heck out of the dog. But your dog is being rude. No dog's mouth should be near anybody's crotch. Next, we have a client that came in today that had his freaking crotch. There was somebody at our last T3 that was literally like degloved. For all my military folks out there, you know what degloving is. No dog should have its head. It's rude. So, Alexis, let's stop that right now. It won't get better. The dog does not grow out of it. The dog grows into it. You let me sniff crotches without a punishment, okay? I'm going to think it's acceptable. Remember, the lack of no is always yes. Next.
Red Riding Hood and the Wolf. Thank you. I feel a lot better now. I will try to smile.
Good. Thank you.
I don't know how to say this word.
Raquel.
Okay. Raquel here from Brazil. Yep.
Yep.
Hi, Jeff. Just wanted to say I love you. Joelle is awesome. I'm loving the content as always.
Raquel, I miss you. I'm still waiting for my invite. I'd like to come down to Brazil next. And congratulations on all your success.
Bug 512, Henry Ford.
That's one of the theories. Yep, Henry Ford.
Isn't it Abraham Lincoln?
Well, Henry Ford is his. That's right up there. That's the thing. That's the thing. So I don't know if Henry Ford took it. Henry Ford ran with like Napoleon Hill, men of industry back then. So people that built the railroads. So there was a lot of thinkers that Henry Ford was around. So, but possibly Lincoln. Yeah, next.
Tony Cash. I don't catch many live shows, but I do my best to watch them when they go up on YouTube and watch a lot of your free content.
Awesome, Tony. Thank you so much.
M. Trombley, 1977. Hey, guys. I hired a dog trainer that I've known people to have very good results with. He's pretty pricey. I have a 6-month-old American Bulldog. The problem is that he has a kid trying to help me train. The kid really cannot communicate with me. I think he's intimidated by me. Only about halfway through, and I don't feel like I should continue having to use his kid as a trainer.
Well, I mean, I don't train dogs actively. I mean, my staff does. I mean, but if you feel that there's no connection, you can sit down and be like, listen, this is not what I thought. I mean, did you think you were getting that person or did you think you were hiring the company? So people hire our company, but I'm fully like, people are like, oh, I can't wait to work with you. I'm like, you won't be working with me. Like you, before you give us any money, you will know, like you don't work with me. So, you know, I run the company and I make sure my staff stays busy by making sure dogs come through the door. So, you know, that's that. If you don't think it's working, sit down with the person. Like if you haven't communicated your concerns, how is the person supposed to know? That's the way I like to look at things. How are they supposed to know? So let's just sit down, and I'm sure you know there's a level of maturity and professionalism there. So let's put it out there. All right, next.
Karen. Wait, just kidding. No, Bug 512. Good evening. Love the show so much. Great information. If you're headed down I-81, check out the Kind Roots Cafe in Lexington, Virginia. We would stop there with our motorhome when traveling.
Oh, nice. Thank you so much. We're on the 81. Next.
Karen, hi. When I call my dog to come in the house, he comes halfway, then stretches, then comes to me. He knows the command. He doesn't wear a leash in the house. Correct stretching with e-collar? Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, okay, put it this way. If you don't want to, and a lot of people will be like, what's the big deal? Big deal is the dog can stretch on its own time. I mean, the dog knows recall. Is the dog doing it on purpose? I mean, the dog's doing it enough that you have to jump on my show and ask. So it's probably not a one-shot deal, right? So I get a feeling that dog's like, it's like your kids. Come on down for dinner. I'll be right there. Like, well, your food will be gone when right there happens. And there'll be a shitload more chores on your chore list. So I would highly encourage you to stop whatever you're doing and to cook this fine meal that your mother prepared and have some respect. So what I would do is speed that up with a remote collar. Next.
Raquel says, this is too funny. Gal Jez, hey, Jeff and Joelle. Today was my first day working with my dog on e-collar. Got to say, I was a bit nervous.
Yep.
I followed your YouTube videos about e-collar, but I still wasn't sure I'm doing it right.
Well, yeah, I guess you won't know till you fuck it up, right? So, you know, this is the thing. Everybody's afraid. Well, I was invited by the Scottish government to sit down with them and to come out and to literally help them formulate a plan for remote collars. When I got over there, I told them, I said, you know, just to let you guys know, I'm against regulation. So, which didn't make my host very happy, but it's like, I just wanted that on the record. It's like, I don't think you guys should regulate these collars. So, but they're going to, they're not banning them. Scotland's not banning them. The last I heard, I'm pretty active with the government regulation of remote collars over there behind the scenes. But what we talked a lot about was, like, they're talking about, like, well, they only want them sold by certain people and then everyone should be trained. And I'm like, that's ridiculous. That's just silly. No. Make these collars good quality collars. So I give them four brands, Garmin, Sport Dog, Ecollar Technologies, and Dogtra. So, by the way, guys, like those four manufacturers, like literally, like. Okay, so what happened was, I'm just like, hello, where are you guys? Like where are you guys in the fight? I don't see that. I don't see the manufacturers in the fight of the banning. So you're leaving it up to the dog trainer. The attitude of the industry is this. So the remote collar industry, their attitude is this. We'll let the trainers fight the fight. That doesn't seem right. You know, let them hire people like lobbyists, like the underground fence people did in the UK. The underground fence people get rid. Do you know that in the UK they want to ban remote collars, but they're allowing underground fencing to stay because under the guise of public safety. I'm like, public safety. Remote collars are huge public safety factors for the positive. They hired a lobbyist. They came in. They were able to, you know, for some reason, everyone's something that's more power, 10 times more powerful than a shock collar, which everyone's okay with. You know what I mean? So, but anyway, the reason why people are not going to mess up their dogs with remote collars, because they're afraid of messing up their dogs with remote collars. So you'll do fine. Next.
Offman, hello there. I'm a fan from Morocco.
Oh, hey, Morocco. I haven't been there yet, but I can't wait. Thank you for joining.
Emily Richardson, I put my corsos back in crates this week. I have so much more control when I come home. Thanks for the advice.
Huh.
Jumping has stopped.
It worked.
I do like the security aspect of having one out, though. They don't chew or destroy anything. Literally just sleep while we're gone. But I will leave them in crates for a while. It is so nice to not get beaten up when I get home. LOL, thanks so much for all your vids.
Emily, I'm not sure if you're pro gun or not, but if you are, take a weapons course. Okay. The NRA has got great, great trainers. They have male and female trainers. Okay. They actually are concerned for your safety and they want to make sure that you learn how to handle a weapon properly. Okay. I'm not sure what country you live in, but if you live in the United States, I mean, just because here it's guns are easily available, which hopefully they'll stay that way. And learn how to protect yourself with modern technology. And a weapon is a handgun is a fantastic piece of equipment. And, you know, and this is the thing, you've got two corsos. Like, so there's, you've got motion detection security lights. Got it? You've got locks on your doors. You have got video camera surveillance. All this stuff is very inexpensive right now. And then you've got dogs. So there's a lot of layers between before someone gets to the dogs. So what I would do is the chances of somebody breaking your house with your dogs. So if I broke into someone's house and I saw two big dogs there, I would probably neutralize them before I got in. All right. So you're probably not going to need them to protect you. But what's going to happen is your dogs are going to jump up on you every day and they can possibly jump up on guests. Next.
Often, can I train a Malinois to stay calm in the apartment to guard it? Because last year, someone broke inside my apartment and stole many things in the house.
So you can if you want to, but, you know, you two different questions. Can you train your Malinois to be calm? Yes. Can you train a Malinois to be a home security dog? Yes, you can. That's above my skill set. You would have to talk to a personal protection trainer, not a sport dog person, but someone that does personal protection. And the thing is, that dog will bite whatever comes in. Keep that in mind. It will bite whatever comes in. That would be the goal, except for you. That's the goal. So anything that comes in there, the dog would bite. Next.
Galjez, I couldn't get any response from my dog at first using a stim level at 6. I was trying that on myself first and it felt a little bit, so I changed the mode to a vibration and he jumped right away. Should I use vibration or go up on the stem level?
Okay, Emily? Is it Emily that asked that? No.
No. Galjez.
Galjez, you said you were watching my videos, correct? Where have you seen on my videos to go to vibrate? And where do you see on my videos that I say level 6 is the magic number? Stop putting it on you. So last time you went to the vet, they shoved a thermometer up your dog's ass to take its temperature. Did you jump up on the table and said, me first? When you feed your dog food and you put it in the bowl, are you like a Russian politician? Are your dogs a Russian politician? And you taste the dog's food first? Let me try some of that kibble first for you to make sure it's safe and edible. Last time you shit, hopefully it wasn't outside. It was probably inside. And the door was probably closed. Correct? You get what I'm saying? So you don't need to try the collar on yourself. Stop using vibrate. Go up on the level. All right? Follow my videos specifically. Got it? And I love you. Next.
Barbara says, missed everything, didn't I?
I don't know what happened, Barbara. I don't know.
Where you been?
Where you been? I don't know. I'm pretty calm tonight. What's going on?
Emily says, I'm way pro-gun. Haha. I'm in South Carolina. Good. We have the dogs to protect the guns.
Okay, there you go.
Kayla, positive note today was the first day my terrier saw a rabbit. He took off. I called him and he turned on a dime and came back. No e-collar. Proud of that at least.
Kayla, you're killing it. Good job. Proud of you. Very impressive, by the way. Next.
Karen, thanks, Jeff. You're right. I asked about correcting the stretching dog, and he was doing it every time. Thanks for your help.
Karen, this is what I want everybody to do. I will answer every one of your questions, except for Grant's. I will answer everybody. That's for all my regular viewers. You get that one, right? You get it. And Grant's like, he's already getting his freaking pocketbook out. Do you know that Grant paid $1.99 just to flip me off?
That's awesome.
But I love that.
Best money ever spent.
It's probably the cheapest someone's ever. Brand, you could have flipped me off for free. You know that, right? You don't have to spend $1.99. It's like, hey, everybody, flip me off. Everybody throw me $1.99 and put the fuck you emoji right up there right now. All right? I'll take it. I'll sit back and take it. I want 50 people to do that. That's dinner out. So what I want you to do is let's all use common sense when it comes to dog training. Next.
All right. Greg says Jeff loves the vibrate feature. Just kidding.
Yeah, I do, but not on my dog. Next.
Raymond, Hey, Jeff, my Shiba knows recall. However, she's starting to develop a habit of shaking her head when I recall her.
Yeah.
I will recall. She'll take a few seconds to shake, then come over. She usually shakes her head after a strong correction. Should I correct on the habit of shake on recall?
You know, dogs do pick up that habit. I would keep a long line on the dog and just pop the dog. Just like correct that with a long line. Next.
Top chat. David Smith.
Looks like a David Smith. If David Smith ever changes his little emoji there, his little thing, we'll be confused. Realize today I've neglected threshold training. First GSD pup since 2000. Other was three. Lug one hole and other opens. Love the guy, but shit. David, you're talking in code. we don't have a handshake, and we don't have a language, all right? And we don't have a clubhouse. And like when I was in prison, I would get letters and I like figured out different codes. That's like why I got out of prison and they still can't find me because they can't break the code. But it's like, I don't get the code. But David, I love you. Next.
Gal Jazz says, thanks for your priceless advice.
You're welcome.
Raquel is cracking up.
Raquel, we haven't seen you for a long time.
Gabriel, hey Jeff, love you.
Gabriel?
From Hawaii.
How's Hawaii? I love you too. I love you a lot.
Let's do a seminar there.
I did a seminar there.
Not with me.
No, I didn't.
Laura. Yep. Attended one of your sessions in Greenville. Incredible and helpful. I have three dogs on prong during walks. My newest pulls after prong correction will come in line, but have to correct over and over.
So Laura, remember the 180 move that I did? If not, go to my YouTube channel. In my YouTube channel, in my search box, not the general search box of the YouTube, but in mine, put in 180 move. I think it's with a Rottweiler. Do that. Works every time. Switch to remote cower heel as well. Next.
Expat prepper. If I buy from you, can you send me training equipment via FedEx or DHL because I'm in the Philippines?
I can't. I could, but we don't. We're too lazy. All right. So what I want you to do is go to Learburg, L-E-E-R-B-U-R-G. Go to Ray Allen. Go to Amazon. Go to Amazon. Next.
Raymond says, understood. Thanks, Jeff.
You're welcome.
Raquel is cracking up.
Okay.
Look at all those ha-has. Raymond, make the online admission happen for your seminars for 2019.
We're close. We're doing t-shirts first. T-shirts and coffee mugs.
They're going to be good.
Those will be out soon. We have to finalize those this week. Did you get the designs over to our person?
I did.
Thank you. So we're finalizing designs this week. I meet with a screen printer this week. We probably should do pre-orders. Mm-hmm. Once we commit, let's get pre-orders so we know how much to order. Okay. So we talk to Amanda, coordinate with Amanda, get those up on the website. Okay. Next.
Top chat.
$5. Woo-hoo. Make your holler. Y'all are hilarious. Emily? Thank you.
Thanks,
$5. Ooh, find some bullets with that. Next.
David Smith says, that was plug one hole, another open.
It's like whack-a-mole. It's true. It's like whack-a-mole. It's called dogs.
Yep. He said, damn. Yep. Jamal. Hey, Jamal, where you been?
Jamal, where the hell have you been?
Where have
you been? Jamal, where have you been, man? We love you.
Hey guys, is it common for your dogs to get curious when they see a dog attempting to redirect on you?
Well, I've got an interesting story. First of all, by the way, I miss you and I love you, Jamal, and I hope everything's going well with you. I used to bring, girl, I haven't done this for a while. My dogs stay in the RV when I do seminars, but I remember I work with a lot of human aggressive dogs. There's a lot of dogs that are my seminars that want to bite me. And girl was in a, I didn't have a crate with me. So she was in a big pen, a 4 foot by 6 foot by 6 foot high pen. You know, they had in the training center right out in the open. And a dog came out. This was in Dallas, Texas. And a dog came out. The handler handed me the leash. It's a human aggressive dog. And girl is like, she literally just lies down and goes to sleep at seminars, as well as like right now. Right now, we've got three large high drive dogs next to us. And I didn't even warn them today.
Because I have your Chug It Stick.
Yeah, I'm going to buy another Chug It Stick tomorrow. Don't worry about it now. I'm not going to take the Chug It Stick. It's no big deal. So I just literally, I grabbed the leash and girl woke up from, they're never really fully asleep. They're always like, sort of like, is Jeff going to like ask us to do something? But they were, girl was rested. As soon as I grabbed the leash, I just grabbed the leash. She immediately got up and started trying to clear the fence, barking her head off like crazy. I mean, she was in there all day long watching me work with dog, not watching me. She was in there all day long. I grabbed the leash of a human aggressive dog and she went nuts. The dog wasn't even going after me. So girl, it's challenging for girl to, when a dog is a human aggressive dog, it's very challenging for her to not want to rush to my aid. So next.
That looks like we already answered that question. And Batman. Albert from Chicago.
Oh, hey, Albert.
I was at a gas station walking my Doberman off leash, and someone commented to me asking, who trained your dog? I had to answer them truthfully, Jeff Gellman.
Albert, you did, but thank you.
David Smith.
Make sure you say .com after that. Next.
David Smith says, pup, just a lot of work I forgot about.
I know. No shit, man. Mm-hmm. We did that. It's always funny when it's some, this isn't you, David, but we have some older clients like in their 70s and they get puppies and I'm like, oh my, are you ready for this? Guess the oldest,
put the phone down.
Back when I used to go to clients' house, the oldest client that ever got literally an 8 week old puppy, the oldest client, oldest client. Yeah. How old?
How old
is
the client?
Yeah. How old is the client?
80.
93. A 93-year-old woman got an 8-week-old puppy. And I'm like, damn, you are optimistic. I'm like, jeez.
Yeah.
You want to talk about optimism? My God.
Jamal said he's referring to board and trained dogs.
What was the question, Jamal?
Dogs get curious when they redirect on you.
Oh, well, they're not in the room. And I don't work. No, they're not in the room. They're in their kennels at work. Yeah. Next.
Raquel says, Jeff, next year you and Joel can come here to Brazil for a seminar and a lot of laughs. I love you so much. This is the best show.
Well, Raquel, you should see the funny ones. This isn't even a funny show. Okay? So, seriously. So, Raquel, do you want to plan a seminar there? Like, we've talked about this for years. If you want to put, this is the thing with you in Brazil. Also, anybody out there in Singapore or anywhere over in some of the Asian countries, I'm available to do. So I'm always looking for locations to do seminars, guys, by the way, especially international. So if you have a place for me to do a seminar, if tools are legal in your area, let me know. I'd be more than happy to do a seminar there. I'm available. There's 4 countries I'm not allowed in, and then there's Cleveland Heights.
You're banned from actual countries.
There's 4 countries I'm not allowed in, but the chances of us doing a seminar there is slim to none. Next,
Shane Turner, you are without a doubt the best dog trainer out there.
I don't know about that, but thank you so much.
JS Fitness Bahamas.
Wow.
Ooh. How do you correct a puppy, Belgian Malinois, who likes to bite when playing?
So this is the thing. I'm a family pet dog trainer, so I'm going to eliminate it. Got it? So I'm going to eliminate it. So if you talk to a sport dog trainer, which is fine, they're going to tell you to redirect. They're going to tell you to give it something to bite. But I don't want that. So I want the dog to, and but I also believe that you should give that dog an outlet for biting. So, but as far as being a family pet dog trainer, I eliminate it. Boom. So what I do is when you were talking about an 8 to 14 week old puppy, I will take my finger or my whole hand and I will just put it into the dog's mouth. And then I'll do that. Also, you can use a bonker. A bonker is this. It's a towel. You would say no, and you would go like this. But what's the end game with this dog? So this is what I suggest. If you, in as far as the Bahamas is concerned, a buddy of mine, Eric from Van Ness Canine, he works with your government doing for your working canines. There are people there that have got a skill set to work with a driving Malinois. You've got to decide if you want to do sport with this dog or personal protection with this dog. You're definitely going to want to be teaching this dog the minimum tug. and definitely how to be equipment trained, which is like using a, you know, a bite sleeve. And it's all based on their prey. So you're not putting them into defense. You know, it's going to be all prey. Next.
Josh. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Thanks for doing the show. I have two dogs and I'm training one of them, Duke. My mother and I walk the dogs together. When we walk and I try to go ahead, Duke refuses to go. He tries to stay with my mom and the other dog. I'm using an e-collar. How do I get him to come with me instead of staying behind with them?
So, Josh, I'm assuming, which I shouldn't do because 5 points for this movie, it'll make an ass out of you and me. What's the movie, guys? And what year came out and who's the person that said it? Who's the person that said it? If anybody grew up in my era, I'm 52 years old, you will know. All right. Chances are, let's make sure your dog's on a leash. And your dog's on a leash, you have a remote collar, heel is heel at my side. So what I would do is I'd be like, you're going to heel next to me. So it's pretty much a simple protocol. Next.
Gabriel says, how has Tex been doing?
Tex has been doing fantastic. You want to talk about a speed demon? Now that he's not injured at all, this boy can freaking run. And he is powerful. He hits hard. So he's doing really great. Next.
Barbara says, I would have a perfect dog if I could only stop the jumping. She's so excited and loves people.
So Barbara, if I came over to your house and your dog jumped on me, I don't care if your dog likes me. Okay. Your dog, okay, my dogs like people too, but they don't jump on them. So Barbara, let's stop that excuse. It's your first time on the show, so I'll be kind to you, but I really will be kind to you because that's also my mother's name, and I can't say, like, get your fucking shit together to you, Barbara, because if that was my mom, she'd go back to the wooden spoon and the soap down my throat. And, you know, so what I'm going to do is this. I've got a video on how to stop jumping. Watch it. It takes 3 seconds. Any decent dog trainer can stop jumping in 1 to 3 seconds. I can't train a good sit in that amount of time. Jumping is extremely easy to stop. I don't want you to keep using the excuse that your dog just loves people. Your dog jumping on my son, it wouldn't be pretty if that happened. Your dog would all of a sudden not love people. I would make it not love people because you can't jump on my kid. You can't jump on me. So I'm not encouraging people to be violent with dogs at all, but it's massive disrespect. You know what's wrong. That's why you jumped. That's why you came onto the show and you asked a question. But I have a video. It's easy to stop. I want you to watch the video. What I don't want you to do is all the bullshit that everybody keeps telling you to do. Turn your back. Baloney. It's stupid. That's wrong. It's like, it's just wrong. You know, dog will jump on your back. It's common sense. Ignore the dog. Don't ignore the dog. Tell the dog to sit. You actually don't want the dog to sit. You want the dog to not jump. Okay, so you apply proper punishment in an effective way. It literally takes seconds to do. I've never met a dog that I couldn't stop jumping. Like, I do this in my seminars, right in front of everybody, live. Next.
It doesn't take 20 times.
No, it doesn't take 20 times.
Angela, yous are awesome.
And we's guys appreciate you. Next.
Andrew.
Yeah.
Well, you don't know. There could be an accent. My healer mix shakes ridiculously.
You live in Rhode Island, so.
My healer mix shakes ridiculously. If I tell her to go upstairs, she will lay in a corner and shake with her ears back. If we go to daycare and she is there for too long, she will sit in a corner and shake.
She probably is stressed. She's probably stressed. Your dog is saying, well, the daycare part is probably, your dog's probably stressed. It's overwhelmed with the amount of pressure that there is. And you can say, everybody's friendly at the daycare. Probably so. All the dogs are nice. Probably so. It's too much for your dog. It's just too much for your dog. So as far as with your dog, if your dog, tell your dog to go upstairs, put a leash on it and bring it upstairs. All right. Is that his
name? Top chat.
Top chat. Angela Ragone, $5. Thank you, Angela. Next.
Raymond says, actually, wait, just kidding. Raquel's laughing. Her and I would get along.
Yes.
Raymond says optimistic.
Right.
Greg says, what, 93 puppy? No.
Yep.
Jamal, thanks. Definitely still consuming all content and surprisingly busy with the boarding trains.
Good.
Awesome.
So I'm not surprised. You did a consult with me. Like, Why would you be surprised? You did a consult with me. You did a couple consults with me.
Greg says, you know you're someone when a country bans you. Whole country. What, four? So four countries.
I was twice I wasn't allowed in Canada. Twice I was turned away at the border.
You had to sneak in.
No, I tried to. I went to another border. And then I went to another border crossing. And then they were like, the guy goes, have you ever been turned down from this country before? And I'm like, yeah, yesterday. I mean,
it's like, right up the road.
Yeah, I couldn't lie. Yeah, I got turned away from Canada. Next.
Allie, my 75-year-old grandma just got a standard poodle puppy.
Allie, make sure she has our phone number. Thanks.
Raymond, hey, Jeff and Joelle. Raymond Cota from Los Angeles. I'm a dog trainer doing in-home clients. I would love to soak up your wisdom. Any Los Angeles trips in the near future?
Hey, Raymond, thanks a lot. I'll be in LA for T3. Go to t3seminar.com, t3seminar.com, February 18th through the 24th. I'll be there. Actually, that's going to be a great little social media story because I'm actually flying out there with Romy and Angelo. I'm flying into San Diego first because that's where my folks are. So I'm going to fly into San Diego, the three of us, and I wonder how they're going to feel about me sitting in first class and them in coach. So that's a joke, guys. I'm going to get a first class ticket for Romy as well. And little Angela, who's six, he'll be back in coach.
Yeah. He'd have such a good time with the flight attendant.
They'll probably love him.
Oh, yeah.
They'll love him. It's like, watch, keep an eye on this kid, would you? So that's the only time I'll be there lately. But I usually do a seminar down in San Diego, but this year I'm not. Next.
Let's see. Laura says dazed and confused.
Maybe. I don't know if that was the one I was thinking of, though. It's probably been used in a lot. This one is a sports one. This is a sports one, and it's a sports coach. It's a sports coach that did it, and it was written on the chalkboard. Next.
C.M. McDonald, The Odd Couple, Felix.
Probably. The Odd Couple, Felix, maybe. That's even before this. That's before this. That's before the movie then. Next.
Deborah, finally found the way to enter conversation. Watched a lot of videos. Always seems to come back to you. Been watching a lot. Owner of Red Healer from Oklahoma.
Oh, awesome, Deborah. Thanks.
C.M. McDonald says we are old.
Yes. I'm not old at all, man. I'm just getting started. I'll be 53 on January 7th. January 7th. I'm just getting started. I'm at 50%. I'm only at 50%, man. I'm going to 106. Next.
106. Next. All right. Deborah says, Yelp, stop the jumping.
Yep. Next.
Gabriel, Joelle, are you considering doing a bodybuilder contest? Just wondering. No, I just enjoy lifting weights. Yep. Kay Parker, would a 4-foot by 4-foot X-Pen setup be an okay substitute for a crate for an older large dog?
No. Get a crate. A crate is a crate. Next. But you can do whatever you want to. Next.
Lisa, 5-year-old lab, started him on the treadmill using your videos. He seems to enjoy it. Thoughts on how much running versus walking I should shoot for?
I mean, you have to remember that our cadence is different than the dog's cadence. They've got four legs. So when we run or jog, they sort of trot. So, you know, that's going to be personal choice. Personal choice. Next.
Beverly, is a 50 on Ecollar 300 same as on the Ecollar 1200? How do these collars compare?
1200 has better range and goes from low to high. Let's see, it has farther range and goes from low to high. So the numbers are going to, they both go to 100. So the numbers will mean different things. They'll mean different things. But the dog will always tell you what number to go to. Next.
Beverly. Nope, I just read that one. Yeah. Ellie Wynn, have been talking to her about your training. She's in Cincinnati, but we've discussed her staying with me in Boston to maybe do one-on-one or something.
That's a great way. That's great, Ellie. Thanks. I'd love to meet Grandma.
She also says she is not technology savvy.
No, it's okay.
Anirbis, any ideas when you'll host a clinic in San Diego?
Sabrina, I was going to do one in Ramona. but my last 2 months of the tour, which I would already be on right now. So what I normally do is I start in Frederick, Maryland, go down to South Carolina, and then I head to Texas, and then I head west. And then I'm on the road for 2 months. So right now I would have already done, I would have been in Texas, heading to Arizona right now. And then for Thanksgiving, I would have been in San Diego. And the first weekend of December, I would have been doing a seminar in. So possibly not till 2019, December next.
Heroes Workshop. My friend's dog barks at the TV when there are dogs on the screen. They humanize the dog too much. Does it really need to be watching the TV and focusing on it? They need help, getting worse. I have a smaller dog. He's around 17 pounds with 10-inch neck around. What collar would you recommend with a low-level stim? The only ones that fit him, I found, have too high of a stim.
Yeah, you're probably, so Ecollar Technologies. Ecollar Technologies will be great. Next.
Greg says, I've heard you mentioning collars that go over 100. Which ones are those? I'm curious.
Dogtra goes to 127. Next. But if you need a more powerful collar, Greg, just get the Boss. Get the Boss. Next.
David Smith. So everyone else doesn't think I'm an idiot. Rocky doing well. Then I realize how much I have to do yet. And he seems to enjoy reminding me of that. LOL.
So, David, nobody thinks you're an idiot, you know, at all.
Nope.
No, people. Guys, you'll notice the flavor of the show. You'll notice the flavor of the show. And it's the same as the flavor of my seminars. My show is filled with a group of loving, caring, supportive, positive, like-minded folks who really want the best for themselves, for their dogs, and for each other. What we've done is we've created a tribe of people that just truly care. They truly care, and they're not headline readers, and they're not affected by all the nonsense that's going out there. And they're truly advocating for themselves and their dogs. And those are the rules to participate in my world. And we rarely have to kick people out of my world, but I do, because it is not a democracy, it is a dictatorship. But it's also through mutual understanding. And once people know the rules, they pretty much stick to it. So this is a really, really great group of supportive people. And my seminars are, I don't know if everybody cries, but there's a lot of crying going on. And I'm usually at the top of the list, because when you're changing somebody's life through you know, eliminating their pain, through helping their dog or helping them, it's pretty empowering stuff. And just the amount of hugs and the personal emails and that I get, and that it's really, really moving. It's really moving. It's a wonderful, wonderful journey right now that I'm on, and I'm really, really enjoying it. And the people that are there as well are truly, truly enjoying it. So that's why I'm looking for more places to do seminars. Obviously, it's also how I make a living, but it's bigger than that. You know, it's way, way, way bigger than that. Next.
Raymond, are those third-party bungee collars for Ecollar good to go, or best to stick with the Ecollar branded bungee Ecollar?
No, you can try the third-party ones. You try this. I think I own a third-party one. Next.
Blue on Black, great advice as always from you guys.
Oh, awesome.
In your Bis, I have the Boss. Are the same numbered stims stronger than the 300?
Yeah, they are, because they both go to 100, but the Boss is about 50% more powerful. Next.
Watering 50, looking forward to Skype session. Girls had great walk away from home, no issues. Lick lips and sit touching each other. Got home and tried to walk more. And new dog attacked. No injuries as usual, but looks, sounds scary.
Yeah, so what you're probably getting, Watering Hole, there's a couple of things. Number one, I'm looking forward to the Skype as well. This is what I want you to do. I want you to realize that you got stuck into a vortex with your past trainer. And I don't name trainers, but if I'm recalling the information properly. So the only way that you're going to have to learn how to properly apply punishments. What I also want you to do is cut out all affection. Literally, affection is what makes dogs aggressive. Affection fucks up dogs that are struggling. They do. If anyone ever asked me, what's the biggest thing that an owner can do to mess up a board and train when the dog goes home. Affection. Too much? No. Just affection. None. Don't give any. And all that sounds is cold and uncaring, but guys, we're rehabbing animals here. If love and affection worked, they wouldn't have been here in the first place. So that's affection. But nobody got a dog not to be affectionate. But nobody got a dog to spend $4,500 on it and possibly have to think about rehoming it or killing it. So what I want you to do with your dogs is I want you to have the mindset that I do. And my dogs have a very good life. They have an excellent life. I'm with my dogs 24/7, but the affection level is probably at a 2 on a traditional scale of 1 to 10. The structure is on a 10, but through structure, that is affection because they are able to do lots of stuff with me. So let's be really, really careful. And also watering hole, don't want them to be friends. I want you to also get under the mindset that you didn't get this other dog. I know you might have, but I don't want them to be friends. They might not want to be friends. They need to be safe. So I want you to start flipping things in your mind, slowly flipping things as you delve down the rabbit hole of my world. Next.
David Smith says, and we really do have the same sense of humor and caring. It's all work. You haven't nailed.
Nice. Thank you so much, David, for recognizing that.
Cheryl.
Some people do get it. Yeah, a lot of people get it. Yeah.
Cheryl says, so true. Collingwood was awesome.
Man, Collingwood was really emotional. Yeah, especially Chantel. Next. If you want to see a really good testimonial, see Chantel's. Just look up Chantel testimonial.
Ooh. That is a good one.
Jeez Louise, I freaking cried my eyes out editing that damn thing. Mm-hmm. Next.
And Nearbus, yes, definitely love the seminars.
Nice.
Cheryl says, glad you can get back into Canada.
Well, it's always a risk.
That is up for debate.
No, I mean, when I go there, it's always a risk. I think I've figured it out now. I know how to play the game. But I get pulled into secondary once in a while, and it's usually a random secondary. I talked to actually somebody that worked at the border, and I figured out some stuff there. But I sometimes get, once they RV the, they put the RV through the 18-wheeler truck x-ray machine. I remember once they pulled me and my two dogs out and they sent in three folks. And I'm like, and no dog, they didn't send a dog in. So it's like, what exactly are you looking for? I mean, I could have had a family of five in the freaking shower because you didn't even look in there. They did a real, guys, it's your borders when you're looking at RVs, like understand how they're constructed, number one. But number two, like at least look in the shower. There's three of you in there, right? You look in the shower, like underneath the sofa. Do you know that underneath the bed of an RV, you can fit a family of five? Like you might want to look underneath there because you didn't send in a dog. I could have had freaking 100 kilos of cocaine in there. You wouldn't have found it. You know, I do have a 100-gallon water tank in there. You know, so I mean, like, learn how to freaking properly search an RV in a timely fashion so that you use your they were all men, so I'll say manpower in an effective way. And then I'm out in the rain. Next.
Greg says, it's hard seeing your dogs at their worst, but witnessing the change, it's a great feeling. Hard to explain to someone who hasn't been through it.
I know. Next.
Maxacina, I would like to hear your debate, a positive only trainer.
I would never. I don't get into discussions with balanced trainers. I would never enter in a discussion with any trainer. I'm not interested in discussing it. That I'm not mad at you, by the way. So, you know, I'm not mad. I'm passionate TM. This is the thing. Like, I'm not interested in debating or discussing anything with any trainer. That's a waste of my time. I could be helping people. All that would be is that I wouldn't do it because it's a total waste of time. It would accomplish zero. It would accomplish zero. This is the thing. You know, I'm a positive trainer as well. I'm a food trainer. We use food. I clicker train dogs. So my staff spends more time food training than anything else. What's the number one tool that they use at the training center? Food. We use clickers. We do marker training. We do a ton of positive reinforcements. That's how we train dogs. Every obedience command that we have is the positive reinforcement training. So the problem is that folks know you can't stop an unwanted behavior. It's impossible. The only way to do it is through the proper application of punishment. But I would never, I mean, that's why I've got a show. I'm not interested in that at all. Next. Some people are. I'd rather just help people. Next.
Daniel. Hi, Jeff. I got a new dog 2 weeks ago. It's a 2-year-old female that pees when I touch her, especially when I'm trying to put a leash to get her to go out of the crate. Any ideas?
Yeah, you got a nervous peer. Unless it's excitement, but it sounds like it's a nervous peer. Get yourself a slip lead. Get yourself a slip lead. What I want you to do is this. Zero affection. None. No affection. But it's a nervous, fearful dog. No, it's a dog that pisses when you fucking touch it. So touch. Touch is a trigger for your dog. Eventually, you'll be able to do it. So what I want you to do is check for UTI, but it's probably not medical. It's probably behavioral. So everything is just neutral. Good. No excitement. Slip lead on. Put your dog out. Let's go. Lots of structure. Next.
Ross, I have a 10-year-old pit bull and a 6-month-old boxer mix. I've been walking every day. All they do is pull at 100% strength, 100% of the time in every direction. The puppy's neck is bald and red, and I feel terrible.
So, Ross, you're brand new to my show. Welcome to my world. I want you to know that you can stop that tomorrow in 5 minutes. 99% of the time, that can be stopped in less than 5 minutes, no matter the size of the dog, how long it's been pulling for, and how big of a puller it is. 99% of the time. So what I want you to do is get yourself a prong collar, okay? So you need 3-millimeter prong collars, okay? They're $25 to $30 a piece. Get the ones made in Germany. Amazon has them. You can buy them from me if you want to. You know, I don't really care. I don't make a lot of money on product, you know? So on t-shirts, I'm going to monetize the fuck out of those, all right? All right? So, but this is the thing is, that you get a prong collar, watch my video, and if they're pulling on the prong collar, it's being used improperly. All right, next.
Greg says, they're looking for meth labs. Thanks, Breaking Bad.
Yeah, it's true. Next.
Deborah, my red heeler will not bring the ball back. He's so bored, it seems like he would play.
Well, those dots don't connect, Deborah. Those dots don't connect. This is the thing. You need to, first of all, maybe your dog's like, doesn't like fetch, but I don't teach fetch. If you want to learn how to do fetch, there's something called forced fetch. Forced fetch. You can watch, just learn those videos. But maybe fetch isn't your thing. So Ronan, my Turkish Kangal, he doesn't play fetch. He just like looks for rabbits. You know what I mean? And eats grass and just like that's what he does next.
Greg says we have to schedule a Skype soon too.
Greg, you know how to get a hold of me, buddy. Looking forward to it. Next.
Christina, I'm transitioning my formerly reactive dog from structured walks only to adding in semi-structured long line hikes. We'll off-leash train in the future. I frequently recall her and put her in a heel when needed, but feels weird allowing her to forge ahead and play even though she's behaving well. Any guidelines for this transition?
Christina, you're on your own journey. My dogs are off-leash trained. I want my clients' dogs to be off-leash trained. I think a hike, though, heel is a little bit impractical on a hike. So get your dog to just like you said, let it be ahead of you. Recall the dog back. You can do that. So it sounds like you're on the right path. But I'm also not hearing about any behavioral issues. So that's sort of the important part as well. Next.
Max Asina, the animal shelter in my city says prong collars are evil.
Well, I really don't give a shit. First of all, again, it's like, I'm not, you know, it's like, first of all, I don't give a shit what an animal shelter has to say. So, like, animal shelters, you want evil? If you really want to see what evil is, go into an animal shelter. Historically, those are evil. So, like, that's big deal. That's like an actor making a political statement. Like, who gives a shit? Just because you're a fucking actor, you think your opinion has any value? It's like, go sell erectile dysfunction medicine like the rest of them do. It's like, who gives a shit? Like, who really cares what your animal, I'm not mad at you, by the way, but it's like your animal shelter saying that prong collars are evil just shows that they're also stupid people, because they're not evil. Evil is the killing of a dog that can be easily changed their unwanted behavior and not doing it because of ignorance. That is evil. That is evil. A prong collar is not evil. No tool out there is evil. Nothing. Whether I believe in the tool or not, I don't use a tool because I believe it's evil. I don't use a tool because I believe it won't be effective in the situation that I need, or I have a better option. But it just shows that how immature they are and childish they are and unknowledgeable that they are. To say that a shock collar is evil is ignorant. To say that a crate is evil is ignorant. But shelters, like, who cares what a shelter has to say? I could care less. Next.
Chris. Hey, Jeff. First time here. I saw your training on Kennel Up, but when there comes a point where I have to apply pressure to put him in the kennel, he doesn't walk in but gets down like a tug-of-war pro.
So we see that all the time. And guess what? You're going to win this one. So in my seminars, which we show everything, I mean, it's live, it's in front of people. We have dogs that will fight to the death to not go in. Literally, they will hunker down. They will jump over the crates, around the crates, put their sides out. They will bite your leg. They will crocodile roll. They will scream and they will yell. And guess what? At the end of the session, they're going in and out of that crate on command, happily. Why? Because there's no other option. You just make it non-negotiable. Guys, your dog does not dictate the rules. It's a dog. You dictate the rules. It's a dictatorship. So, and I'm not this big, tough guy that yells and screams at dogs. I'm a very gentle trainer. I just make things non-negotiable. I don't reason with dogs. They're animals. And that way I can have dogs around me that are safe and they're balanced. Next.
Karen, hi, I've been structured with my dog and no affection and he's 100% improved. Is it okay to bring affection back in 3 months or never? You're great. Thank you.
Nobody got a dog not to be affectionate, including myself. You're smart because you're watching my show and your punctuation is proper. So what you're going to do is start bringing it back and see what happens. Got it? Start adding things and now the dots will be connected. Next.
Deborah, Yelp positive reinforcement. I'm glad you brought it back.
Cool. Next.
Gary, hi Jeff. Just got our second dog puppy, GRD, because the first is doing great thanks to you.
Awesome.
Challenge now is getting a big 3-year-old to be good with the 11-month-old. Any advice?
Yeah. So Gary, don't try to have them be friends. Work on existence, lots of structure. Make sure you advocate for both dogs. Crate both dogs up. Feed both dogs in the crate. Same rules apply. Make sure that you don't give that new dog affection because it's new. It hasn't earned the right yet. It hasn't done shit for you. So definitely want to step up your game. Just step up your game. Next.
David Smith, t-shirts. I'll take a fecal float, please. That's the second request.
We might, we'll figure something out, but we already have the four. We already have four that we're putting, that are going to press.
Next. Maybe we'll make a mug.
Yeah. Guys, so just let you know, mugs, we're going to do more designs on, because mugs will make sense. Next.
Jamal says, common for aggressive dogs with injuries to digress. Won't get into the details, maybe during Skype, but just curious.
Yes, it is. And let's do a Skype. Yeah. When a dog is injured, a lot of stuff can happen. Next. Because there's a couple of coping mechanisms that dogs use to hide injuries, but then there's also things that they will do more of. They'll do more of things and less of things. So injuries are pretty interesting because a lot of it's based on the survival mechanism of an animal. Next, not to show weakness. Next.
Is that intentional?
What?
You said next like 15 times.
Did I? Yeah.
Scandalisa. I like that name. Can you fix your crooked picture behind you? LOL.
Guess what? Right before the show, I made it crooked just to piss people off.
It actually looks straighter than maybe it's the angle.
Yeah.
Straighter than it.
So, nope. You got to sit through the whole damn show looking at that. And maybe you'll send me an email and maybe you'll be like, man, if I can, I straighten that out. Like, yeah, nope. I do. I've got a reasoning.
That was really exaggerated.
I've got a reason for everything I do. Next.
Max Asina, I agree with you.
Good. You don't have to, but cool.
David Smith says, oh my God, don't get me started on the dancing monkeys actors. Any tool can be misused. Hammer, knife, gun, prong, know your tools, get trained, stay safe.
That's right.
Oh, that's a t-shirt.
That's right. David's already got it. Next.
That's Greg. Yeah, I can see you doing that. The picture. Me too.
It drives a lot of people crazy. Mm-hmm. My daughter, Olivia, drives her nuts. Did I tell you she's gotten two sponsors now?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Killing it.
Yeah. Wildcraft Knives. Yeah. Did you see she's having a Tina, the next live is going to be what day of the week is today?
Today's Saturday.
So Monday night. And that's going to be 9 p.m. That's going to be with Linda. That's your date night. So, yeah, Joelle's got date nights on Mondays. So she has the night off. Mm-hmm. So Linda does that. It's a 9 o'clock show because Romy's got ballet until – she doesn't roll until a little bit after 8. And then Linda's got to go eat. What I should do is this. Why don't I just go out to dinner with Linda on Monday nights while she's at freaking class?
That would be nice.
Not so she starts the show quicker, but it's like, I was asking her, I said, why don't you just go out to eat? Because she sits around with most of them are moms. All the moms sit around for a couple of hours and they chit chat. I'll tell you that one time I walked in there. So I walk in there to drop off Angelo. Because Angelo does ballet because all the cool kids are, and Angelo's a cool kid. I walked in there and it's like they're all laughing and chit chatting, and I'm like, I was expecting cocktails to be passed around. Yeah,
ballet.
It's fun.
What
they're there
to
for
ballet?
They're there for hours. You know, it's a peanut free zone.
Okay.
Yeah, they really like crack down.
Can do that.
Yeah, I think you can have peanuts in the lobby, but not in the dressing rooms. Yeah.
Yep. Interesting.
Yep.
So you read Dana's, right? When is your next slide?
Yep.
Nicholas, hey Jeff, my dog will walk politely on a prong collar, but when he sees another dog or squirrel, will completely disregard and pull hard. I've tried a bonk and he ignores that too. Bonk harder? Haha.
Bonk harder. No, not necessarily. Watch my 180 move. Watch the 180 move, and also the dog's probably walking politely because there's no distractions, obviously. Distraction comes in. That's when the real dog training starts. Next.
Dana says, see you then.
Awesome. Thanks, Dana.
Nicholas, thanks so much for doing these.
Nicholas, it's actually my pleasure. I feel honored and I feel blessed to be able to do these. I feel great. It's even better now that people do super chats. I love that. That they do super chats. So that's been really, really great. Next.
Chicken Little says, can I be a moderator?
No, not at all, Chicken Little. I don't know who the hell you are. So, nope, I already got a moderator, and I wouldn't let someone, just anybody, be a moderator at all. But thanks for the offer. But I don't know who you are. You've never been on the show before. You've never been on the show before. And I wouldn't let somebody outside my inner circle, you do that, but thanks for asking. Thanks for asking. So
he said okay.
Okay, cool. Well, I love you.
David Smith said night, guys.
Hey, take care, David.
Bye, David.
Take care. All right, looks like it's winding down. The show is winding down. So
hour and 20 minute
show. RVdogtrainer.com. I've got a great seminar coming up in Florida. It'll be great to see everybody. It's on the east coast of Florida. It's between sort of Gainesville, Orlando, and then the beach area right there. I just don't know the name of the city. I should freaking learn it by now. It's like right by.
Between Gainesville and Ocala Forest? Is that what you said?
No, it's next to the Ocala Forest.
Well, Forest.
No, I know that's why I let the person get a free pass on Forest, because it's the Ecollar Forest. So, Allie, the best coast. I don't know. I've got houses in Bradenton. I got houses in Bradenton.
Yeah, the West Coast is pretty nice.
I don't know, man. The Gulf Coast is pretty nice.
Yeah,
Gulf Coast is pretty nice.
Clearwater Beach.
I know.
Got a top chat.
I know. Top chat from Canada too. Oh, my the country of my choice to I think I'm okay now with Canada.
That's good.
Yeah, I'm okay.
What are the other ones you banned?
You know that if you can't, this didn't affect me, but like DUI, you can't go to Canada for I think 7 years.
Wow.
Yeah, there's a bunch of domestic, there's a bunch of US crimes if you commit, you can't actually go into Canada. Yeah, you get banned from them. Yeah. So Jane says, thanks for everything, Jeff and Joelle. I hope to make it to Seattle in February with a few other Jeff fans I know here in Vancouver, Canada.
Woo-hoo.
Jane, first of all, it'd be great to see you in Seattle. I really love it. I would love to do a seminar in Vancouver. I'll tell you what, why don't you put something together? Put something together in Vancouver. That'd be great. There should be enough people there. Next.
Karen, thanks for doing this show. Have a good one.
Oh, thank you so much, Karen.
M. Trombley, 1977. You are a great human. Thank you.
Oh, my gosh. Wow, thanks.
Wow. Blue on Black, why do you think the subjects of dogs brings out the crazies no matter if you are a trainer or rescuer? I've seen it on everything relating to dogs.
Well, the thing with Blue on Black, this is what it is. A lot of people are drawn to dogs because they don't like people. Now, I mean, most of us own dogs and we're fine. But a lot of people are drawn to dogs from the rescue. So the rescue world is filled with broken people. And if this, you know, when I say broken, that doesn't mean sometimes it's necessarily bad. But a lot of people, and a lot of people will take offense to this, but I mean, if we really think deep about this, a lot of people that are some of your hardcore rescuers, for some reason, they're using the dogs as an emotional crutch to make up for, to replace, to ignore, to suppress some usually mental discomfort that they're struggling with. You get a lot of people that are in the dog business that are actually really bad with people. Therefore, they don't know how to interact with people. Therefore, that they're actually mean to people and they're actually anti-human. I find it really ironic that people that are in rescue are actually anti-human, considering that you need the human to get the dog out of the rescue situation. So we see that over and over and again. Most people in the dog industry are actually not people, people, which is unfortunate because you sort of need to be. So you need to be. I mean, that's how you're going to be successful, is by being really good with people. So that's what we see.
Lindsay says, looking forward to the Florida seminar, 2 hours away from me.
Oh, good. That'll be fun. Next. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. It's going to be good. Under the big top, we're renting a big 40 by 40, like, wedding tent. It's going to be nice. I've done a couple of them, actually. When I first was like, do I really want to do a seminar underneath a big tent? But then I did one in Scotland, which was fantastic. And then I did one in Canada in Collingwood, which was just great. To Justine and John, it was great.
It was
awesome. It was beautiful. And we're doing one in Florida. And it's not going to be too hot. So I'm really looking forward to that.
Yeah. Jane T says she's looking for a place here too, Canada.
Oh, that'd be great. Next.
Melissa, I listen to your show often and I can hear my husband laughing at your quips in the next room. Thank you.
Thanks, Melissa. That's good. Tell your husband I said hi.
Scandalisa, you're a trainer I trust because you feed your dogs raw meat. I never would have touched a prong collar before watching your videos.
So this is the thing. Well, first of all, yes, there's a lot of good dog trainers out there that don't feed raw. There's a lot of really crappy trainers that do feed raw. But thank you so much. But I think that it's really, really great. I think it's really, really great that we've built trust. And I think that that's really important for, I do a lot of business consulting. You know about the January dates, right? Austin,
I'll
Texas.
Well,
I gotta,
you just tell me and I'll go.
I got to tell Jess, so make sure you're scheduled, not on the schedule. Okay. So know, like, and trust is what you need to establish in order to have voluntary transactions with people. So know, like, and trust is really, really important. So I'm glad that we've established know, like, and trust. Next.
David Smith. FYI, tortoise was 458.
Okay, write that one down.
Remember that. I'm going to find that clip.
Okay, cool.
Doesn't he say the issue and then he comes back in and says, oh, by the way. Or no, that's the
next one. We'll find it. We'll find it. Yeah, we have to maybe do 458 and 459.
Yeah.
Next.
CM McDonald, are you ever coming back to Long Island?
That location, probably not. That was challenging for people to get to. So, but you're close to me. Come to the Providence seminar in March. You're actually local. We get a lot of Long Island people that come to that seminar.
Mm-hmm. You're going to Jersey too.
Oh, there's one in New Jersey. Go to the New Jersey seminar. It's right by Philadelphia too. Next.
Karen, you're coming to De Pere?
Yep.
In April?
Ooh. Yep, I'll be there. That'll be fun. That's a brand new location for me as well. The Beckett School of Dog Training, I think it's called.
Nice.
Yep.
David Smith, for your entertainment purpose?
Yes.
Chevy, dang it, miss it.
Chevy, man, what's going on in New Zealand, buddy? What's happening over there?
It's too much fun to be on YouTube Live.
What are we, 14 hours? What is it? It's Sunday. Is it Sunday at 11:30, 11:25 a.m. Sunday over there? Right, next.
Deborah, happy holidays. Good night.
Good night, Deborah.
Good night, Deborah. Chevy, found out that New Zealand trainer I mentioned was trained by Caesar, Sean, and Tyler. Pretty stoked. Maybe she will host you?
Maybe. If she likes me, you got to find out. Yeah. So ask. I'll be more than happy to go over there. Was it the Balance Pack? Is it the Balance Pack? There's a wonderful trainer out there that she does. She's really doing well with social media. I follow her. I wonder if it's the Balance Pack. Yeah, next.
Chevy says he was painting.
Oh.
And it's Sunday at 3:30 p.m.
Wow, New Zealand? Is that big of a time change? Holy shit, really? It's 18 hours. Wow, I didn't know you were 18 hours. Yeah, it's really weird. Like when I was in Australia, it's like it was tomorrow. Wow. Yeah, everything was tomorrow. Yeah.
Did you not sleep at all?
Now I struggled over there too. I struggled. All right, guys, we're going to close out the show. I want to thank everybody so much for showing up tonight. It really means a lot to me. You're all very, very special. Thank you for participating. Thank you for your super chat cash. Thank you for your comments, for your likes, for your watches, for your eyeballs, for your time. Thank you so much for your time. I mean, you know, there's only 24 hours in the day, right? And we all have the same amount of time and we decide what we do with that time. And for folks to spend anything from, you know, 2 minutes to the whole time on this show. And if you're watching the replay, thank you so much for watching the replay. I really, really treasure every minute that folks spend, you know, hearing my voice, and I definitely don't take it for granted. And I want to make sure that I put out some really, really good, helpful content, but also, yes, entertaining. I mean, this is a podcast. It should be educational. You should laugh. You should cry. You should think. You should bring back memories, maybe from anything from yesterday to you know, your childhood. You should be hopeful for the future. You should be happy for today. I mean, there's so many wonderful things that are going on out there. So guys, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I really, really appreciate all your time. And take care, everybody.